Hello, art lovers. This is Art Loft Remixed. In this special edition, we revisit a few of our favorite stops in Broward County. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing.
And you see all these amazing dancers, you just kind of stand on the sidelines like, how is this possible? How are people doing this together and making this look so neat?
Dillard High takes on the Ellington Jazz Competition.
They have to become creative, okay? And when you become creative, academically, they normally excel or they start excelling.
We meet Hollywood artist Virginia Fifield.
People, their instant reaction to charcoal is, ick, because it's so messy. And I've managed to figure out that by working vertically, I'm able to keep my paper pretty clean.
The NSU Museum of Art is taming a cobra.
Didn't want to know anything anymore of academism, of the tradition in Europe. And at the same time, we had ideals about the future society.
From the Keys to Fort Lauderdale, it's the South Florida Symphony Orchestra's amazing journey.
When I started the Key West Symphony, I imagined it to be something that I would get to come home and do these concerts with some friends. Tonight we had 70-some musicians. It's taken off.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft Remixed.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.
We kick off this episode of Art Loft Remix by kicking up our heels.
Swing dancing actually originated in Harlem in the 1920s and 30s, and then it's technically called a jazz dance, and it's a group of swing dances. So there's different types of swing. We normally do East Coast swing and Lindy Hop. And it got popular again in the 90s, the late 90s, when Brian Setzer and like all those groups kind of came out and became really mainstream again, and it kind of stuck. And we've had a scene in South Florida ever since.
As an adult, it's hard to find a good hobby. And I come from a fitness background, so the acrobatic nature of it and just the overall athleticism and then the crowd, that's what drew me in. So you get to dress up once a week, if not more, your choice, and come out and dance. And everyone's just here to dance. We personally do East Coast, which is the traditional, the 40s, the 50s style. West Coast tends to do the same basic rules, but to modern music. We keep it more traditional with the 40s and 50s music, big bands, etc.
Started swing dancing. I went to a Magic 102.7 summer sock hop back in 2000, and they had a dance contest there. And me and my husband went, and we're like, oh my goodness, we didn't even know people still swing dance. The DJ that's here tonight, he was handing out flyers for a swing dance coming up, and they gave lessons, and that's how we started dancing. There was a 1 hour lesson before every dance, and that's how we started.
You don't need a partner. You don't need a right and left foot. All you need to do is learn some basic rolls.
My first experience swing dancing down here, you go to swing dance, and you see all these amazing dancers. You just kind of stand on the sidelines like, how is this possible? How are people doing this together and making this look so neat? So, well, this look, I actually went to like Men's Warehouse. I was like, you know, I'm looking for a suit and a vest. And then I saw like one of the mannequins over in the corner, you know, with the spinners. And I was like, actually, you know, that looks really cool. And I like the whole look and everything. And just like the style and like the dance and the music, it all really comes together. It's really neat.
Like, I've got an eye for fashion, so I'm always like, you know, keeping an eye out for stuff like that, anything in that vein. I tend to kind of walk to the beat of my own drum. I don't like to look like anyone else or follow anyone else. So I mix and match, take pieces from different eras. I will mix, whatever influences me, 70s, 80s, 90s, I was a 90s kid, 40s, 50s, 60s, whatever I can find, put it all together. Found them in a Spirit Halloween store. So they're actually supposed to go with a 40s gangster mall kind of a costume, but I just bought them for funsies because they looked really cool and they turned out to be incredibly comfortable. So I throw them in with my outfits whenever I get a chance.
Well, one night I was riding my bike around Central Park and all of a sudden from Lincoln Center, I heard all this great music and I rode over there and I saw about 200 to 300 people outside swing dancing to a big band. And it was just a lot of fun. Well, this is a little Betty Page with the flower and the hair on the side, and I guess tropical 40s look. It's a lot of fun, and I think when you're coming out to hear period music, when you're dressing vintage, it definitely enhances the experience. I'm actually having a knee surgery on Monday, and that was the biggest concern with my doctors. I told them I have to get up and dance as soon as possible. I love it. It keeps you young.
For me, I always love dressing up. It's something that I've always liked since I was a little kid, so it's awesome that I get to dress up and dance to music from an era that I wasn't a part of.
It's wonderful. The dances that they're doing now, I did 70 years ago, and it's great. I'm having more fun now because I'm an old guy and everybody wants to dance with me. It never disappeared, really. But there were different eras that they danced by themselves there. That was, and then the swing dance came back and that was the end of it. Everybody's swing dancing now.
This is all about just my desperate infatuation with the 1950s. I have been hooked since, I think, 2009. Got introduced to swing dancing in Tampa. I went out for college, and from swing dancing, from the music, I just became completely and totally in love with the 1950s style, music, movies, cars, you name it, I love it. The one thing I can do that's that I'm not hurting myself. I'm very clumsy. It's just very fluid, it's very natural. I would say if you want to get into it, don't get discouraged. You're not going to get it the first couple times. Anything that's worth anything is with work. And, you know, once you start getting things, one thing starts to click for you, it really opens up another realm. I live another life that isn't very common in this modern hustle and bustle world. I get to come out, relax, and, you know, kind of live in a time that doesn't exist anymore. It's kind of amazing.
Up next on Art Loft.
People, their instant reaction to charcoal is, ick, because it's so messy. And I've managed to figure out that by working vertically, I'm able to keep my paper pretty clean.
Music students take on the Duke as Dillard High travels to compete in the prestigious Ellington Jazz Competition.
This is my 10th year at Dillard, and in the beginning it was difficult because I had to, you know, develop a culture, I had to develop an environment, but I'm happy to say that like maybe 5 years after being at Dillard and working and putting things in place, we're moving in the right direction.
So, rhythm section. What we're gonna do is we're gonna be vibing and we're gonna be grooving, all right? And I'll be like, you know, I'll say stuff to you guys. You guys just play. You do whatever you wanna do. Okay, we're gonna follow you.
When a student is studying music, they're gonna use both sides of their brain. They have to become creative, okay? And when you become creative, academically, they normally excel or they start excelling because of the discipline that is needed to be a musician.
Mr. Dorsey just really wants to see his students that he gets as young teenagers. He wants to see them grow into adults. I think he just does a great job of shaping people, and he's sure shaped me.
He tells you straight up, he tells you how things are, and but you know, he's not the guy who'll just sit there and like help you and say, okay, this is exactly what you do, but he kind of leads you to it though. So he'll say, you know, Anthony, you got to work on your tone, and you got to work on Clark studies.
This is our fifth year coming to Ellerton. The first year we made Ellerton was in 2010. And I'll never forget when we made Ellerton, we were just happy to be here, okay? And I think one of the things that Ellerton has done is help the young people to really develop confidence.
I was kind of oblivious my first year because I was a freshman. I didn't know what was going on. And I wasn't really a part of the band. I just got in the band. I was 14 years old. And it seems like I grew more mature as I came here during the years.
I started playing in sixth grade. My mom, she told me I should play trumpet because my great grandpa, he played trumpet. So she said I should play trumpet. I didn't want to do it. I wanted to play basketball. Okay. But I'm kind of short, so you know that wasn't the best thing for me. So I started playing trumpet, and at first I didn't like it, but eventually I grew to love it after hearing Freddie Hubbard play. So I just started practicing for hours and hours and hours. I got trumpet lessons. Then I went to Dillard Center for the Arts. Then I got to do things like go to New York, and that, you know, opened my mind to what's out there musically.
The most important lesson I learned over the 4 years is the lesson of family and working together with people. Because I feel like in a lot of bands, it kind of becomes a thing of I'm here and you're there. And you kind of get separated. But a big thing that happens in our band is that despite some people being at an extremely high level and some people still being at a high level but not as high, that we still find that balance of connecting as people and coming together as a band so we can have fun and swing.
Over the 4 years, I think I've really changed as a person and as a musician, of course. Just learning from Mr. Dorsey and learning from students around me, I've began to like teaching others, and I feel like the things that the seniors passed on to me when I was a freshman, I'm now trying to pass on to the freshmen now.
One of the things that I want to take from Ellerton is, first of all, is the fact that we're around like-minded people. You know, they're playing on stage in front of an appreciative audience, first of all, because everybody that's in there, they appreciate what's being done. And this is one of the only places where you're going to be able to take your young people that are between the ages of 14 and 18 that are doing the same thing they're doing. The next thing is a learning experience for them. Another thing is they get to hear different bands. They get to hear the personalities of those different bands. And then they also get a chance to see that they have a personality. And they have a personality that is good. It's a good personality in our band. They're learning how to get along with their own peers in their own band, but they also learn how to get along with other kids because they're out there mingling, talking to other bands. It's a competition, and yes, everybody wants to win. You know what I'm saying? But the great thing about the festival, for the most part, it's learning. It's a learning situation for all these young people.
Up next, the NSU Museum of Art is known for its Cobra art collection. But there are no snakes involved.
Didn't want to know anything anymore of academism, of the tradition in Europe. And at the same time, we had ideals about the future society.
Meet Hollywood artist Virginia Fifield.
I work in charcoal because I really like the black and white contrast and drama and power of black and white. And I work in nature subjects because I want to communicate my feelings about nature and the subjects that I select, the beings in my drawings, to communicate the wonder and miraculousness that I feel about them. Most people, their instant reaction to charcoal is, ick, because it's so messy. And I've managed to figure out that by working vertically, I'm able to keep my paper pretty clean. And fortunately, all the dust falls off rather than stays on the page when you're working flat. But I've really developed a lot of techniques that have allowed me to achieve the effects that I want. You know, I use erasers a lot to draw. I wear rubber gloves when I work, and I discovered that I can use them to blend and get those nice soft grays. I'm trying to express the uniqueness and wonderfulness of these creatures and to initiate a revision of them for us. And I hope that through my drawings, I'm able to have you come and look at them in a fresh and new way, to consider more than just them and their uniqueness, but also in a way that makes us think about our relationship to them. So in my drawings, you'll often see them looking back at us in the form of portraiture, where they're also drawn on very large scale, human scale. So they're looking back at us and considering, as we consider them, they seem to be considering us. And then there are other marks of tattoos on horses' necks, halters, collars, tags in a sheep's ear, all signs of our ownership and control of them. Most of the images are photographs that I have taken, and so I've had direct experience with them. For example, the ram, which was an SPCA rescue, and so the photograph is of him, a portrait of him straight on, and he's just kind of looking at us with these old eyes, and you can see his teeth, and his teeth almost look like human teeth, which is something that really appealed to me about the image. I didn't want to really anthropomorphize him, but at the same time, I felt that the teeth were a nice identification because it's like us. And yet, he has this tag in his ear, US, you know, USDA tag, but that tag there is also the title of the piece, Us or US. You can think of it that way. When I'm drawing, I'm always saying to myself, look. It's kind of the message in my work too, is that you really have to look to see that wonderful relationship that I believe we can all have with the natural world.
Up next, the South Florida Symphony Orchestra.
When I started the Key West Symphony, I imagined it to be something that I would get to come home and do these concerts with some friends. Tonight we had 70-some musicians. It's taken off.
While Cobra was the most important or the only avant-garde movement in Europe after the Second World War.
The Cobra movement was an avant-garde art movement in post-war Europe. It was made up of artists from Copenhagen, Brussels, and Amsterdam, thus the acronym COBRA. You know, art was a spirit of experimentation and collaboration.
So different that they were just, that people just couldn't comprehend. And just after the war, they wanted to continue the way things were. They just wanted to follow the easy lines, and it was way too experimental.
Well, what they really wanted to do is spontaneity. And they were against traditionalism, against academism, and they wanted a real contact with the matter, the material.
They wanted freedom, they wanted the unconscious of Freud and Marxism also. The theories of Marx were very important.
And it started really with ideas. At one side, in their work, they wanted to be really primitivist. They didn't want to know anything anymore of academism, of the tradition in Europe. And at the same time, they had ideals about the future society, that society would change and they would be the forerunners about how art would be then.
Cobra founding paper was really one simple paper where they just said, we don't want to continue the way it is now with surrealism. It's much way too intellectual, and we don't like the linear forms of all the abstract art right now. We want to have a more free and from within art, more expressive art.
The Cobra artists worked together as a group from 1948 to 1951, but so much of their work was about collaboration and experimentation that even after the Cobra group officially disbanded in 1951, they continued to work together throughout most of their careers.
The leaders, not all of the group, but the leaders, Asger Jorn from Denmark and Constant from the Netherlands and the writer Christian d'Autremont from Belgium, they were very Marxistic.
He met Asger Jorn in 1946. It was in Galerie Pierre Loup, Rue de Seine in Paris. And it was during that time in the gallery a Miro exhibition. That was also the starting of the later Cobra group. And Constant coming back in Holland, he started immediately to find experimental artists to connect to get the same experimental group as there was already in Denmark, the Hurst group. And in 1947, Corneille and Appel visited Constant because they heard about this endeavor of Constant. And that was the first exhibition of all three, Appel, Corneille and Constant.
And there was a lot of parallels between the artists in the United States and Europe at the same time. Paris, before the war and certainly right after the World War, was still the center of the art world. But by the early 1950s, as one author put it, New York stole the idea of modern art. The power structure and the gallery system, as well as the new art, was all seemed to be coming out of New York. Or at least that is how art history was written for the last few decades. It's only been in the last two decades that art produced in Europe after World War II has risen in its importance in art history, at least in the United States. I think it was always important in Europe. It's only that we're just catching up now. In America, this movement has been understudied and underappreciated. However, with the growing impact of artists from Eastern Europe and Germany and the rest of Europe, who were influenced by the Cobra artists, it's essential for us to understand what this movement was really about and how it influenced the next generations of artists.
But it was a movement that really made its own, had its own publications and its own meetings, and was not a movement arranged by the government or given a name by some journalist. It was really a kind of more or less a political movement.
Their visions really were shaped by their experiences during this turbulent time. And very much like the artists in the United States, such as the abstract expressionists, Jackson Pollock and Mark Rothko and Barnett Newman, they were looking to make a break with the past and to start anew, create a new work for a new time, work that was international, work that dealt with the inner workings of the mind.
And they were inspired by a sort of primal source within. I feel they thought the children had, the mentally ill had, all the artists from Africa had that made the masks.
But they wanted that also everybody should be free to be artistic and that a new folk art would start from that moment on.
Next week on Art Loft.
The inspiration is changing, or I am getting new inspiration from the mangrove forest and the roots in the trees and all these things. So that is coming through into the work, which is kind of one of the intentions that I had.
The South Florida Symphony Orchestra is a Broward institution, but it got its start in the Keys.
Classical music, it enhances the soul. I'm from Key West. I'm a sixth generation conch. When I started the Key West Symphony, I imagined it to be something that I would get to come home and do these concerts with some friends. Tonight we had 70 some musicians. It's taken off. the musicians come from all over the country. It's like bringing the Olympics. It's the people that are the best at their craft and they're playing together.
I've been playing with the symphony for many years, since they were the Key West Symphony before they became the South Florida Symphony. When you get musicians together from all over the country, it's like summer camp, and it just gives a whole different level of camaraderie that really carries on to the stage as well.
Key West is so proud that there's a symphony. Every piece of music is so different. This is pure love. I want people to come in and be into another world and forget about their life for a minute and just be taken over.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.